When Will came home from work that night, he found 6 bills and 2 advertisements in his mailbox. He pressed the button of his apartment and stood thumbing through the irritating sheath of envelopes as he waited for the buzzer. The door growled, and Will pushed it open and wearily climbed the stairs. "Hello, Anne," Will said, throwing the daily news on the card table by the radio. "Is there any beer?" Will's wife shoved back a strand of damp brown hair from her perspiring face and shuffled off to the kitchenette.
"God, it's been hot today," she said. "Wait, I'll look."
Will took off his collar and lay down on the warm studio couch. He relaxed, feeling the loose spring pressing into the small of his back, but he was too tired to move.
"There's half a quart of ale here,"
Will's wife called.
"It's probably a little flat, but it's cold."
"Anything," sighed Will. "Anything will be fine." Anne brought the brown bottle in and filled the glass for him. It was flat all right. There wasn't even a collar on it, but it was cold. Will took a good swallow and lay back again.
"How's the refrigerator?" he said.
"All right today, thank God,"
said Anne, sinking into the Morris chair by the card table.
"I've got a roast in there for Sunday and lamb chops for tomorrow, and if it starts acting like it did yesterday, I don't know what I'll do. The way the meat is these days."
Will took another big drink of the ale and listened to the blaring radio and the expiring refrigerator motor in the kitchenette.
"Machines," he said.
"What, Will?"
said Anne. "I was just thinking," Will said. "I was just thinking about machines.
My God, we're at their mercy from morning till night. We don't run them. They run us."
"Well," said Anne, "you know we can't afford a new refrigerator after the last cut you took."
"No," said Will. "I know. I was just thinking about machines."
He lay there feeling cooler, but somewhat relaxed from the ale. "Anne," Will said, "that radio is awful loud, honey. It gets irritating as hell listening to those damn commercials all the time. I'd rather listen to the refrigerator. Would you mind turning it down a little?"
Anne sighed. "I can't," she said.
Will turned his head and looked at his wife.
"Are you kidding me?" he said. "What do you mean you can't? Are you kidding me?"
"It broke today,"
Anne said.
"The knob that runs the volume is stuck. You can't make it any louder or any softer. You can't even turn it off."
Will stared at the big stain on the living room ceiling.
"Machines," he said.
"Today I drive my Pontiac to town in a few minutes to see the latest Paris gown."
He thought about the August day just ending. His job in the accounting department at the warehouse, the rows of maddening little numbers, and the unpleasant breath and growling voice of McFadden, the chief accountant, forever at his shoulder. At lunchtime you grabbed a tasteless sandwich at the corner news luncheon and read the paper while you drank your coffee.
The bomb,
the jet fighter,
the machine. You lay awake at night in the little hot box you shared with your wife, and listened to the city beyond the fire escape, the hollow, lonely rattle of the manhole cover, as the taxi sped north on Lexington,
the plane that droned across the night sky, as you lay there thinking about it, and hoping it was full of mail sacks, and movie stars, and salesmen from Detroit and Los Angeles and Toledo. One of ours, you thought, smiling securely when it was gone. One of our machines.
Take Carter's Little Liver Bills as directed. Get them at any drugstore. Only 25...
"Good Lord!" Will cried suddenly, sitting up on the couch and staring at Anne. "Can't you do anything about that radio?"
I told you, she said quietly. It's not working properly. The knob is stuck. It won't shut off. And you can't make it any lower.
Will went over to the ancient 10-tube console and tried to turn the jammed volume controls.
Friends, said the radio, have you looked ahead for security? Do you think only of today's needs and of the present? How about those kids and your little wife?
Will turned the selector knob and slapped the scratched veneered cabinet sharply.
Damn it, he whispered, almost sobbing.
And now the news, said the voice. Members of the Atomic Energy Commission met today to consider new peacetime applications of nuclear.
Will whirled the worn dial knob desperately till he found a dance band playing from a hotel in Newark. He lay down on the studio couch.
You can't even turn it off, he whispered furiously.
All you can do is get something else.
He and Anne ate supper in silence that evening. They sat around most of the evening reading the daily news and some old copies of Life magazine that the Rosens had given them. When the radio became too maddening, Will would go over wearily and find another station. At 11 o'clock, after the late news, Will turned the dial to what seemed a dead frequency, and he and Anne went to bed. That night was even more unbearably hot and airless than the torpid and stirring day had been. Will finally managed to doze off and had slept for nearly an hour before the radio awakened him. He lay there, listening to the faint throb of dance music in the living room. Anne stirred and mumbled thickly as Will, cursing softly to himself, got up and went into the living room. He stared at the single yellow malevolent eye of the radio. Then he squatted and groped sleepily amongst the baseboard for the wall socket. Suddenly, a thousand lightnings snatched and gripped Will's bare, perspiring arm.
Damn it!
He whispered, shaking his hand till the tingling stopped. Then he gingerly grasped the wire and pulled it. The plug would not come loose. Will gave it a hearty yank. It had fused or rusted into the rotten fixture and was as grimly unyielding as the tentacle of some loathsome animal clinging for its life to the corrupted, crumbling corpse of the old apartment house.
Well, think of the twilight, a little home in a stick, or rhubarb, or suburbs, covered with mortgages.
Will looked up at the evil yellow eye and squatted there, stupid and helpless, blinking back at it and listening to the faint cross sounds of two dance bands somewhere behind the night. Will went back to bed. He lay awake for nearly an hour, thinking about the radio. The machine. He shivered lightly and felt the nervous sweat cool on his bare chest. He thought about the radio in there, in the living room, looking into the dark with its yellow eye. It was almost as if the thing were alive. Will felt foolish about it, and yet he knew presently that it was something he had to do. He rose stealthily, shut the bedroom door, and locked it. Then he lay back down again, sweating in the stuffiness, and trying not to think about the machine in the living room, defying him. He listened as if he half feared he would hear it, prowling insolently about the empty rooms like some weird insensate animal. Will thought once he actually had heard it, stalking woodenly into the hallway, sniffing at the locked door.
Machines,
Will whispered to himself again before he fell asleep.
What a beautiful picture.
The next day being Saturday, Will slept till after 10. The day was hotter than Friday had been. Heat seemed to rise like glowing gold wires from the asphalt of 23rd Street and clutched the apartment like the mesh of a cage. Will went next door to Fred Rosen's and played pinochle till past noon. He spent the remainder of the afternoon on the studio couch, looking at the Sunday supplement of the Journal American. Anne had gone next door to Rosen's for a cake recipe.
Suddenly Will realized that he could endure the radio no longer.
"Friends," it was saying, "when you think of beer, think of mellow, cool Krausmeister's beer. The hops are tops."
Will leaped from the couch and ran over to the radio. He tried again to twist the stuck knob, but it was useless. He turned all the other dials and beat furiously on the top and the side of the cabinets with both fists. He felt the nervous sweat break out on his body.
"Take a tip from your friendly neighborhood druggist. Don't let sluggish intestines rob you of summer fun. Take Snyder's Gentle Easy Laxative in the big economy-sized bottle."
Will sat down on the couch and put his head in his hands. He listened to the faint, friendly voice of Anne gossiping with Mrs. Rosen in the next apartment. She would be upset, he realized. It would really be a cruel thing to do. The radio meant a lot to her during the dull round of days that was her life. The soap operas. The heartthrobs without heart or vein or pulse. The impossible thrills of the impossible Brendas and Rodericks, with their sorrowless sorrows and joyless victories. A world that never was. Still, there was no choice left to Will. He went out to the toolbox beside the wheezing refrigerator and got the ball-peen hammer. Will walked over to the radio and began systematically and with a kind of furious joy to smash it to pieces. When the veneer cabinet was in splinters, Will delightedly went to work on the delicate little silver tubes. The radio was stilled, the evil yellow eye was out, and the room was drenched in a rich and beautiful quiet. Will lay down on the studio couch and listened to the pleasant far-off horns of taxis on Lexington Avenue and the children playing under the elevated railway, and the low voices of his wife and Mrs. Rosen talking about cakes, and the drunken news vendor in the ground apartment. Anne didn't say anything when she came back half an hour later and saw the ruined radio and her husband sleeping peacefully on the studio couch. Even at supper she had said nothing till Will mentioned it himself.
"Anne, I tell you I couldn't take it any more," he said suddenly, putting his fork down. "Those damned singing commercials and the constant yapping. Those girls that sing the song about cold tablets. My God, you don't sing about cold tablets. You sing about birds and love and children. What kind of a world, Anne? This morning, for example, I swear to God they were singing a tune about ingrown toenails."
"It's all right," said Anne. "I don't blame you, Will."
She went to the stove and picked up a saucepan of vanilla sauce she had made for the dried-up layer cake left over from last Sunday.
"Of course," she said, as she served Will the dessert, "it does get pretty lonely all day. You'll have to admit that. You're at the office all day, I mean. I listen to all my programs while I work, and the time just seems to fly. I don't even mind the commercials."
Will stared sickly at his dessert, feeling suddenly wretched.
"Maybe," he said lamely, "if I get that raise in August, we can afford an inexpensive table set."
"I don't really mind them at all,"
Anne continued, as if she'd not heard him.
"I gotten used to them. I even like some of them. Even the ones they sing. There's one that's really sort of pretty, Will. The one about softy tissues. Do you want to hear me sing it, Will?"
"No," said Will, sipping his coffee. "I heard it."
"I remember it by heart," said Anne strangely.
Every word.
She left the kitchenette and went into the parlour. When Will finished his coffee, he went to the door and saw her. Anne was sitting in the Morris chair by the radio, with tears streaming down her face.
She looked old. For a moment, Will really hated her.
I wish I hadn't done it, Will,
she said dully.
My God, I wish I hadn't.
Will's lips went white, and he sat down on the studio couch looking at his wife.
All right, he shouted. I'm sorry. What can I say but that?
We'll get it fixed on payday. If I get a raise, I'll buy you a table model. I told you that already, Anne. What more do you want?
He walked stiffly into the kitchenette and sat down again. Will stared at the Daily News, not seeing the words at all. He heard the squeal of a prowl car on 23rd Street and felt the heat rise and shimmer in the city. Then Will heard the voice speaking in the parlour. For a minute, Will thought Anne was asking him a question, and he strained his ears to hear what it was.
Friends, do you find baking the hot, tiresome chore that it was in Grandma's day? Well, it needn't be. With Aunt Sophie's new Jiffy Cake Mix, you can bake pastries in nothing flat.
Will stood up, trickling sweat and sick. He crept to the door to see. It was Anne. But it was not Anne's voice. Anne was sitting there forlornly by the ruins of the radio, and her lips were moving. But the voice was not Anne's. It was the voice of the radio.
Once you've tried a Sultan cigarette, you'll never smoke another brand. Eminent psychiatrists say it actually soothes tired, tense nerves.
Will staggered back to his chair and shut his eyes and pressed his hands to his ears. He began to tremble violently, and the perspiration began trickling down his back under his shirt. After a bit, he cautiously opened his fingers and listened. Was it Anne he heard, clearing her throat, or was it static?
No need to suffer from nagging backaches. The sharp pain of neuralgia. Muscular aches and pains.
Will got up carefully from his chair, thinking calmly to himself. I will now go into the living room and talk to Anne. She is not well. My wife Anne is tired from overwork and broken refrigerators, and the high prices of meat. I must talk to her. It seemed hours later, years later, Will was very tired. He stood in the doorway of the Rosens' apartment, looking at his neighbour Fred, and wanting nothing so much as to be asked in for a bottle of cold beer and a pastrami sandwich. Then, even before he was aware of the expression on Fred Rosen's face, Will felt his lips moving and heard the voice speaking quite independently of himself. He sighed, realizing that there was nothing in the world he could do about it.
And now the news, said a voice. Police this evening are investigating the brutal slaying of a young woman on East 33rd Street. A few moments ago, the body was discovered on the pavement, apparently hurled from the window of an apartment shortly after the slaying took place.
And even as Will stood there smiling helplessly, with the hammer in his hand, he heard the buzzer at the door.